The fourth Imam, Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal also was of the same opinion. He was so strict that Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, he said, don't write my opinion unless it is confirmed, unless there is an ijma. Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal was more strict because taqleed started. He said, don't write any of my opinions. If you find any of my opinion, whether it be for Imam Malik, or my opinion on Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi, Imam Abu Hanifa, go to the source. And if you find any of my opinion which goes against the opinion of Allah and His Rasul, you reject my opinion. That's the reason I say I am 100% humbly. If humbly means a person who follows the teachings of Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal, I am 100% humbly. Other people are 70%, 80%. So in teachings, if you say following the teachings of Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah's mercy be on him, makes you a Hanafi, I am a Pakka Hanafi, 100% Hanafi. If following the teachings of Imam Malik makes you a Maliki, I am a 100% Maliki. If following the teachings of Imam Shafi makes you a Shafi, I am a 100% Shafi. If following the teachings of Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal makes you a humbly, I am a 100% Saufisad, humbly. Because all these four great Aimma said, if you find any of my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, you throw my fatwa on the wall. See, all the madhabs of all these four great Aimmas was what? What is the meaning of madhab? Madhab means way of going or time of going. Another word for madhab is sunnah. Even sunnah means way. Sunnah of the Prophet means way of the Prophet. So all the madhabs of all these four Aimmas was the madhab of the Rasul. All the Aimmas said, if you find a Sahih Hadith, you reject my opinion. That means all the four Aimmas, their madhab was the madhab of the Rasul. Simple, the way of the Rasul. Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah be pleased with him, may Allah's mercy be on him, he never came to start a new Hanafi madhab. Imam Malik never came to start a new Maliki madhab. Imam Shafi never came to start a Shafi madhab. Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal never came to start a new Hanbali madhab. All of them followed the madhab of the Rasul. Like how the Christians misunderstand Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, never came to teach Christianity. He came to teach Islam. Similarly, all these four great Aimmas, they came to give us knowledge of the teachings of Allah and His Rasul. Their madhab was no madhab but the madhab of the Rasul. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 4, verse number 59, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, and those charged with affairs. With those charged with affairs or with knowledge. You have to follow Allah and His Rasul. After that Allah says, and those who are charged with the affairs, those endowed with knowledge. But the verse does not end there. The verse continues. But if they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul. So if those with knowledge, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Imam Malik, Imam Hanbal, may Allah's mercy be on them all. If they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul. So all the four Aimmas, they said the same thing. If you find my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, reject my opinion. Same thing Allah says, Atullah, Atu Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messengers, and those charged with their faith, those endowed with knowledge. But if they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul if you believe in Allah and the last day. For this is the best and the correct way of determination. There is no better way of determination according to Allah than going back to Allah and His Rasul. It is so simple. Now, there are some brothers who come and ask me the question. Brother Zakir, fine. Those people who have knowledge of Quran and Hadith, for them it is very easy to know what is right, what is wrong, what is Sahih Hadith, what is Zayif Hadith. How can we, as lay Muslims, as common Muslims, understand what is right, what is wrong? It's a very good question. I tell them. Then they say, that's the reason we do taqleed. I tell them, see, what is the meaning of taqleed? Taqleed means, see, following the opinion of any scholar does not make you in the format of taqleed, doesn't make you mukallid. If after showing proof that the scholar you're following is wrong and then you follow him, yet that makes you a mukhallid. For example, if your mother has a heart problem, fine, has a heart problem, and some doctor, what will you do? Who will you go to? You won't go to Tom, Dick, and Harry. You'll go to a heart specialist. You do research. MBBS? No, no, no. MD? Huh? MD. MD in what? In brain? No, no, no. Heart? Yes. So before going to a doctor, you do research. You check up what is his degree. MBBS? No, no, no. MD? Yes. MD in what? Gynecology? No, no, no. Kidney? No, no, no. Brain? No, no, no. Cardiologist? Ah, yes. DM? Super speciality. MD of medicine, then you do super speciality DM. You do your research and then you go to him. You don't blindly follow any Tom, Dick and Harry. If anyone on the street says, your mother has a heart attack, okay, do this. Will you follow him? Will you follow him? No. You will do research. Similarly, the third category, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messenger. The third category, those endowed with knowledge or those charged with their affairs, you do research. Any scholar says anything, check up whether it's right or wrong. See, everything you cannot check up. Now you have heard 10 different scholars. You understand how scholar number A, he has given about 30, 40 references. I have checked up 20. 20 are, oh, Quran say hadith. So 21st you need not check. You check scholar number 2. Scholar number 2, mixture. Part correct, say hadith, part zaif hadith. Third scholar, majority. Pulling fast ones. Sahih Hadith, it's not there. Bukhari, you open Bukhari, more than 7,000 Hadith, you don't find it only. So you have many scholars, you do little research. Now once you make up mind, scholar number 1, when he talks, he gives references. When I checked up the references, Quran, Sahih Hadith. Then what happens? Then when you ask an opinion and 3 scholars give you the opinion, you automatically follow the first scholar. Because I've checked up 20 things of his, it has turned out to be right, even the 21st inshallah will be right. So every layman cannot do research on everything everyone says. So first, but you have to limited research. This scholar number A, he speaks on Quran and Hadith. Scholar A, B, C, D, or scholar number 1. Scholar number 2, or scholar number B, partly right, partly wrong. Scholar number C, or scholar number 3, majority wrong. So you do little research and classify which type of a scholar is he. And then if you follow without doing research scholar number 1, no problem. But suppose you follow scholar number 1, you have done research on. Another scholar comes and says, what scholar number 1 has said is wrong, I give you proof from Quran and Sahih Hadith. You check up the proof. If it is wrong, you reject him and follow scholar number 1. But if the proof that fourth scholar gave you, it is from Quran and Hadith, going against the opinion of scholar number 1, then you reject the fatwa of scholar number 1. So if, see, for example, I am there, when I hear something, what I speak, in the talk I do my research. But there's more knowledge in my head, in my brain, which I haven't checked up. But yet, I classify. For example, if I hear a statement from Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani, MashaAllah, who expired recently, according to me, is one of the greatest muhaddis of the recent times. So what he says, I follow on the face of it. Because I've checked up, he's a scholar, MashaAllah, following Quran and Sahih Hadith. But if someone gets me a fatwa against Nasiruddin Albani, if it's from Quran and Sunnah, I may reject the fatwa of Nasiruddin Albani. But I know, see, every human being can make mistakes. Imam Shafi made a mistake, Imam Abu Hanifa made a mistake, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal made, Imam Malik made. So why can't Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani make? He can make. But he belongs to the group of scholars which checks up on Quran and Hadith. So if someone gives a fatwa, a local person from here, and Nasiruddin Albani, I'll believe Nasiruddin Albani. If I don't have time. But if I say in the lecture, I check it up. What I say in the lecture, I check up. Because I'm responsible for that. But for my own knowledge, if I have to make opinion, I can't keep on checking every hadith. Difficult. Difficult for a layman. So, but to classify which group of scholars are you reading of? Which books are you reading? Whose books are you reading? Whose cassettes are you listening to? You classify them. authentic scholar. This scholar makes 20% mistakes. This scholar 50%. This scholar 90% mistakes. You classify, and then if you don't have time and belong to the first group of scholar, which is authentic, you need not check up everything. If you have the time, it is the best. Do it. Alhamdulillah, mashallah. But don't have the time, yet you can. That's not called taqleed. But if someone shows you proof against the scholar you respect, and yet you follow him blindly, that is taqleed. The taqleed we can only do is of Allah and His Rasul. Bas. Atiullah, atiur Rasul. Bas. No one else. Simple. Simple formula. Now some people come and tell me, Brother Zakir, you talk said, don't make sect. But didn't the Prophet said, there will be 73 sects? I said, yes. The Prophet said, there will be. Prophet didn't say, you should make. Allah says, don't make. But Prophet knew, even though Allah says, don't make sects, the Muslims are bound to make. So he predicted, there will be. He didn't say, you should make. And if you read the Sahih Hadith of Abu Dawood, Hadith number 4579 and Hadith number 4580, it says that Prophet Muhammad said that the Jews were divided into 71 or 72 sects, the Christians were divided into 71 or 72 sects, and the Muslims will be divided into 73 sects. There's a Hadith of Tirmidhi, Hadith number 131, as well as Hadith of Tirmidhi, Hadith number 2643, where the Prophet said that the Bani Israel, the Jews and the Christians, they were divided into 72 sects. But my Ummah will be divided into 73 sects. All will go to hell except one. So the companions asked, who are they? The Prophet said, those that belong to me and my companions. The Prophet said, there will be 73 sects. All will go to hell except one. Those that belong to me and my companions. And there's another hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, hadith number 2652. The Prophet said, the best of the people are those of my time, means the companions, the sahabas. After that, the next generation. After that, the next generation. The Prophet said, the best people are those who are of my generation, the sahabas. After that, the next generation, the tabi'in. After that, the next generation, tabi tabi'in. Finish. So if you have to take anything, you have to take from the generation of the Prophet, the companions, the next generation, tabi'in, and tabi tabi'in. That's it, three generations. This we call as the Salaf-e Salihin, the righteous predecessors, or the righteous forefathers. Salaf means predecessor, forefather. So in the Sharia, in the Islamic ruling, the highest in authority, there are four categories. The highest in authority is the Quran, is Allah's word. If you want to find something, if it's not there in the Quran, you go to the next source. That is the Hadith, the Sahih Hadith, the sayings of the Prophet. In the sayings of the Prophet, the commandment of the Prophet, the call, carries more weight than the actions of the Prophet. So if the commandment and the actions contradict, the commandment carries weight. The third source is the Sahabas, Ijma, the three generations. Sahabas, Tain, and Tabetain. The Ijma of these people, of the Sahaba, carries more weight than the individual opinion of the Sahaba. Then, Tain, Tabetain. And the last source is the Qiyas. If you don't find in any top three sources, in the Quran, in the Hadith, in the lifestyle of the Sahaba, the Tain, and Tabetain, then you can use Qiyas, analogy, deduction. So Sharia on four things broadly, the Quran, the Hadith. No Sahih Hadith will contradict the Quran. Quran number one. Then comes Sahih Hadith. In the Sahih Hadith, call carries more weight than the Amal. The commandment carries more weight than the action. Then the lifestyle of the three generations, Sahabas, Tain. Ijma carries more weight than individual opinion. Then comes the qiyas. So this is how we should follow. We should follow Quran and the Sunnah. But now, all the groups say we follow Quran and Sunnah, Quran and Sunnah. Everyone, no one says he does not follow Quran and Sunnah. So how should the Quran and Sunnah be followed? The way the Prophet and the Sahabas understood. The way the three generations, the Sahaba said, Allah the Rasul said, Muhammad said, the best generation is my generation. Then the next, then the next. So if there is difference of opinion in how to understand a verse of the Quran, you have to see how did the Sahabas understand it. If you don't find in that, then the next generation, Tabayin. If you don't find in that, then the next generation, Tabay Tabayin. This is how you follow. Because many verses of the Quran, for example, the word masah has got two meanings. Sexual touch, physical touch. When you go to the hadith, you come to know it is sexual touch, not physical touch. Easy. Similarly, when there's any difference of opinion in understanding any verse of the Quran, you have to understand according. If there are any other verses, commentary of the Quran, Quran is the best. If not, go to the Sahih Hadith of the Prophet. If you don't find there, in the lifestyle of the Sahabas, the Tabayin, the Tabi Tabayin. Finish. So for proof, for Hujjah in understanding the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, you have to follow it according to Allah, His Rasul, and the Salaf Salihin. This is how we look at it. Otherwise, many verses of the Quran can mean two things. Like the verse in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, that those who are martyrs, they are not dead, they are alive. Some people say, oh, that means they are alive. That means you can talk to them. If the martyrs are alive, the Shaheed are alive, even the Prophet is alive. Very good logic. But how did the Sahabas understood? Did the Sahaba consider the Prophet to be alive? They buried him. They even did the janazah ka salah. Even the martyrs, when they were killed in the battlefield, didn't the Sahabas read the janazah ka salah? Can you read janazah ka salah of a live person? No. So what the Quranic verse says, that when the enemies rejoiced that we killed your people, they are alive. Within the year after, they are in benefit. It does not mean physically they are alive. If physically they are alive, why did the Sahabas bury them? So here, if you understand the Quranic verse, difficulty, two opinions, go to the Quran, the Sunnah, the way of the Sahabas and the Salaf Salihin, and you get the reply. No difficulty. Easy. Don't have to be a scholar. Little bit jihad, little bit research. Little bit, not much. Now, there is another group of people. When I ask them that, who are you? What are you? They say, I'm an Ahl-e Hadith. So I say, what is the meaning of Ahl-e Hadith? He said, we are the people of the Quran and the Sunnah, Quran and the Hadith. So I said, fine, makes sense. So I tell them, okay, fine, if you want to say Ahl-e Hadith, I would prefer calling myself Ahl-e Sahih Hadith. Because I only follow Quran and Sahih Hadith. There are other Muslims who even follow Zaif Hadith and Maudu Hadith. I am an Ahl-e Sahih Hadith. If you want to call me something. See, Ahl-e Hadith means, see, other people, they follow Zaif Hadith, Maudu Hadith, keeping hand below navel, no problem. So, they call themselves Ahl-e Hadith. No, I am Ahl-e Sahih Hadith, if you want to call. So I ask these people, that brother, you call yourself Ahl-e Hadith, means we are pakka, following Quran and Sunnah. I said, very good. So I asked them the question, that which verse of the Quran, in which verse of the Quran did Allah say, call yourself Ahl-e Hadith? They say, we don't find any. Is there any Sahih Hadith in which the Prophet said, call yourself Ahl-e Hadith? No reply. So therefore, I don't call myself Ahl-e Hadith, I call myself Muslims, therefore I'm a pakka Ahl-e Hadith. You all are kacha. 90%, 95%, maybe 98%. I'm pakka Ahl-e Hadith. Ahl-e Sahih Hadith. It makes sense or not? When you say you follow Quran and Sahih Hadith, there is no Quranic verse in which Allah says, call yourself Ahl-e Hadith. There is no Sahih Hadith in which the Prophet said, call yourself Ahl-e Hadith. There is another group of people, similar to Al-Hadith. They say, we are Salafi. So I say, Salafi? They say, I'm a Salafi. So I said, what's a Salafi? So he said, Salafi means following. The Salafis following. I said, even I follow Salafis following. I follow Allah, His Rasul, and the Salafis following, the generation at the time of the Prophet, the next generation, and the next generation. But then I asked him, that did any time, is there any verse in the Quran which Allah says, call yourself Salafi? They say, no. Is there any hadith in which Allah's Prophet said, call yourself Salafi? And they say, no. But there was one Salafi who came and gave me a hadith. The Prophet said, I am a Salaf. And he quoted, Sahih Muslim. Didn't give me the reference. I said, fine. I went to Sahih Muslim. Let's check. There was a hadith. Sahih Muslim, reference is 2405, something odd like that, 2400 something. Hadith, Sahih Hadith. But it was a picked up hadith in between. The complete hadith says that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her daughter, that I am an excellent Salaf for you. I am an excellent Salaf for you. The father telling his daughter. Now Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told his daughter, Hazrat Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her, I am an excellent Salaf. As I told you, Salaf literally in Arabic means predecessor, forefather. So if I tell my daughter, I am your Salaf, no problem. An Arab who's a Christian, if he tells in Arabic to his daughter, I am your Salaf, no problem. So literally no problem. But Islamically predecessors, fine, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was an excellent Salaf for his daughter. But here, every father may not be an excellent Islamic person for his daughter. Maybe the daughter or the children may be more Islamic than the father. So every father can't tell their children. No, literally if you understand the word Salaf, according to scholars, who the Salafis claim to be good scholars, they say that literally no one today can say he's a Salaf. Why? We are Khalaf, we came afterwards. The Salafs are before us. So compared to the previous people, we are Khalaf. Yes, we can be Salaf of our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. So technically we can be Salaf, Islamically we can't. Islamically, we are Khalaf. Clear? Fine. When I'd gone to Australia, the first time I went to Australia, I'd gone for lecture tour, and a group of good brothers, mashallah, following Quran and Sunnah, Sahih Hadith, they called me for a lecture tour. And normally we had correspondence, we came. And we reached in that city. I don't want to name the group, they're good brothers, mashallah. We reached in the night. So I and my camera crew were with me. So we offered Salah. We offered the Salah. So brother said, hey man, you pray like us. I said, what do you mean I pray like you? I pray like the Prophet. He said, hey man, you pray like us. I said, what do you mean I pray like you? I pray like the Prophet. See, this group, mashallah, they are following Quran and Sahih Hadith. But what they should have said, we are proud that you pray like the Prophet. They said, you pray like me. I never saw him praying before. I'm praying from yours. So I'm not praying like him. I'm praying like the Prophet. And alhamdulillah, he's also praying like the Prophet. So what he should have said was, we are proud that you pray like the Prophet. But he said, hey man, you pray like us. Very happy. Because when they called me, they had seen my cassettes, but they did not know. They said, what, Zakir's piece of comparative religion? Yes, correct. But we don't know his Aqidah. So reluctantly they called me, seeing that, fine, I'm a specialist in the field of comparative religion. They saw my cassette, they didn't find anything wrong. But they didn't know my Aqidah. They didn't know how I pray. So they called me reluctantly. But when they saw me praying, they were happy. Ah, hey man, you pray like us. So I said, no, I pray like the Prophet. But they were good brothers, mashallah. So then I gave the same, you know. Then we sat for dinner and we had a good talk. And the same topic I said, I'm a Pakka Hanafi, I'm Pakka Shafi, Pakka Hamli, Pakka Ahli Hadith. So when it came to Salafi, I said, I'm a Pakka Salafi. But nowhere does the Quran say, call yourself Salafi. Oh, there's no Sahih Hadith in which the Prophet said, call us a Salafi. So most of the brothers, they agreed with me, except for one. One brother, he disagreed. All the other brothers, mashallah, Zakir, bhai, brother Zakir, we agree with you. One brother, he asked me, brother Zakir, do you know Sheikh Nasir al-Albani? I said, yes, I know him. What do you think of him? I said, mashallah. One of the greatest muhaddis of our time, that was a few years back, when Sheikh Nasruddin was alive. Rahimullah. May Allah's mercy be on him. You agree with him? He's a good scholar. I respect him, I love him, I revere him. Okay, I will give you his statement. So he went on the internet and he downloaded from albani.com his fatwas. Now reply to these fatwas. And Sheikh Nasruddin Albani, may Allah's mercy be on him, I love him, I respect him, I revere him, I appreciate him, mashallah. And he is of one of, there are two groups of scholars. One group of scholars saying Salafi is fard. And he belongs to that group of scholars, one of the staunchest, saying Salafi is fard. So I said, Alhamdulillah, if anyone, the day anyone proves me from Quran and Sahih Hadith, if today someone proves me, I will accept it today itself. But I will check it up. Huh? If anyone proves to me, the day anyone proves to me from the Quran and the Sahih Hadith that calling yourself Salafi is a fard, or calling yourself Ilyas is a fard, I will call. Or calling yourself Hanafi is a fard, or Maliki is a fard, I will tell that. In action I am, in label, I prefer calling myself Muslim. So when I went to his fatwas, Sheikh Nasruddin Albani, he gave fatwas of great scholars, and he said that Abu Hanifa said, and the hadith he quoted, that there'll be 73 sects, all will go to hell, except one, that is the Jama'ah. And if you cross-reference, Jama'ah means the first three generation. Cross-reference, Sahih Bukhari. I agree with that. He quoted, Abu Hanifa said, Imam Abu Hanifa said, that the Jama'ah means following the way of the companions, the next generation, the Salafist following. I said, I do that. He gave the quotation of Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah. It is obligatory that you follow the Salafist following. I said, I do that. He gave the fatwa of Imam Shafi. It is compulsory you follow the three generation, the pious predecessors. I said, I follow. What's the problem? But did these people say, call yourself Salafi? Abu Hanifa never said that. Imam Shafi never said that. Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah never said that. People assume he said, he never said that. So now, there is no proof from Quran and Sahih Hadith that you should call yourself Salafi. There is a qiyas, a logic of Sheikh Nasruddin Albani. And I appreciate Sheikh Nasruddin Albani, he's a very good scholar. Inshallah, within a few minutes I will end. There's a question and answer session. How I had a question and answer session. If you go to nasrudalbani.com, you'll find there. He tries to convince with logic why you should call yourself a Salafi. He says, questioner and Sheikh replying. Sheikh asks, what are you? The questioner says, I'm a Muslim. The Sheikh Nasruddin Albani replies, what type of Muslim are you? Are you a Khariji? Are you a Mutazali? Are you a Shi'i? Are you a Rifadi? Are you a Qadri? What type of Muslim are you? So the questioner says, I am a Muslim following Quran and Sunnah. What Sunnah? Everyone says Quran and Sunnah. The Khariji says Quran and Sunnah. The Shia says Quran and Sunnah. The Qadri says Quran and Sunnah. What type of Quran and Sunnah are you? So he says, I follow Quran and Sunnah like the way the Salafis Salihin understood. The Sheikh says, yes, very good. You have to follow Quran and Sunnah the way the Salafis Salihin understood. So for this big sentence, in short form, the word is Salafi. And the debate was won. According to the Salafis. The debate was won. And on the internet you go, I respect Sheikh Nasruddin Albani. Many of my talks, when I want to check up a hadith, I see him. So I respect him, mashallah. I love him, I revere him, but no taqleed. No taqleed. Taqleed only belongs to Allah and His Rasul. Fine, see, this is logic, this is qiyas. See, logic, I say, prove to me from Quran and Sunnah, not logic. Alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah. Allah has blessed me with logic. Summa alhamdulillah. I am not a scholar. I consider myself a student of talib ilm, a student of knowledge. But Allah has blessed me that I've missed many scholars, whether it be of the great Indian scholars, whether from Nadwa, whether from Deoband, whether it be the Saudi scholars, Alhamdulillah, whether it be the scholars from other parts of the world. Allah has blessed me. I had the opportunity to interact with the great scholars of the present time. Alhamdulillah, Summa Alhamdulillah. Interacting with them, Allah has increased my knowledge, but yet I am a student. I'm very small. I have limited knowledge. But when logic is there, Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me with logic. So based on that, what type of Muslim are you? Are you a Khariji? Are you a Mutazali? Are you a Shia? Are you a Qadri? Are you a Sufi? Based on that, he won the debate. So he said, see. Then Sheikh replies, no. But the questioner says, but didn't Allah say, call yourself Muslim? So the Sheikh replies, at that time, there was only one Islam. Now, there are different groups. So therefore, it is compulsory, fard, obligatory. You should identify yourself as a Salafi. Logic. Now comes my reply. And that debate was ended there. Sheikh Nasrud Albani won the debate. See, for me, don't debate with me. Prove to me from Quran and Sunnah, immediately Dr. Zakir Naik will accept. Debating, Alhamdulillah, Summa Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me. In debating, Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me. My response to Sheikh Nasrud Albani, I respect him. I am nothing compared to him. I am not even a drop in the ocean compared to Sheikh Nasrud Albani. So please don't get me wrong. Many of my talks are based on his research, mashallah. So please don't get me wrong. I love him, I respect him, but no taqleed. I tell him, fine. If you see the lifestyle in the history of the Prophet, he didn't quote any hadith to me. He didn't quote to me any verse of the Quran that calls us a Salafi. So I don't call. No logic. At the time of the Prophet, there were hypocrites, munafiqs. Fine? They were munafiqs. The Sahabas did not change the name. There were Kharijis, Khawarij, Kharijites. They called themselves Khariji. People gave them the label. The Sahabas yet called themselves Muslims. Did the Sahabas say, give them a new name? No. They continued calling themselves Muslim. They were Mutazalites. People yet continued calling themselves Muslims. So at that time also, there were differences. Not that they were not. Now, coming to the question. That therefore, Sheikh Nasrud Albani says you should call yourself Salafi. My question is, which Salafi? Which Salafi? My counter question. And now, do you know how many types of Salafi? Are you a Qutubi? Or Sururi? Or Madkhali? I can name another Salafi. See, I'm not speaking against anyone. Please don't get me wrong. I don't mean ill to any of them. But even in Salafi, there are various groups. And if you go to UK, mashallah, subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, there are so many groups in UK, each group fighting against the other, calling the other Salafi a kafir. Nauz billah. We'll come to that later on if time permits. So which Salafi do you belong to? Again, see, whatever label you give, there's bound to be tafarraqa. When the Shias came, people said, we are Sunni. Again, there was group, Ahle Sunnah wal Jamaat. Then, again, there was division, Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Malaki. Then we came with Salafi, Ahle Hadith. There's group even in this. The moment the name given by human beings, there's bound to be tafarraku. Even in Allah's name, Muslims are bound to be division. Allah told that. But don't think the name you give will not have divisions. Don't you think Allah did not know? Allah knew there are going to be divisions in the Muslim Ummah. He told in the Quran, the Prophet predicted, yet the Prophet didn't say, call yourself Ahle Hadith, call yourself Salafi. Ahle Hadith, which Ahle Hadith? In Bombay, where I come from, there are two Ahle Hadith. Jamiat Ahle Hadith and Gurba Ahle Hadith. So which Ahle Hadith do I belong to now? One Ahle Hadith blaming the other Ahle Hadith. See, I don't want to mean any harm to the Ahle Hadith. Therefore, I said the topic is sensitive. Wallah, I'm only trying to talk about Quran and Allah's Rasul. Please don't feel bad. I respect Nasruddin Albani. I respect the Salafis. I look amongst all these groups that are there. We have to agree The Ahle Hadith and the Salafis are the closest to the Quran and Sunnah. I'm proud to say that. But, which Salafi? So maybe during the earliest times of Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani, there weren't groups in the Salafi, now there are groups. Sururi, Madkhali, Qutubi. Oh, he's not right. He's calling him Salafi. But so now we have new books, true Salafi. I read a book called Salafi Dawa, true Salafi. What is this true Salafi? I say, you know, we had a Dawa training program in Bombay where we invited people from different parts of the world. There were 19 people from 14 different countries. And many of them were from Medina University, mashallah, from Bahrain University, all more than 50% were Salafi, mashallah. So we had a discussion there. So then I asked the question. Salafi shortcut, short name. Instead of saying, I believe in Quran and Hadith according to the way of Salafi Salih, shortcut Salafi. So I asked him, the Salafi Salihin is better or Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is superior? Who's better? So they told me, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So why not call yourself Muhammadi? Right or wrong? In India, who calls themselves Muhammadi? You know? Do you know? Do we agree with them? No. Who calls themselves Muhammad in India? Who is superior? Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah. So one who submits his will to Allah is called a Muslim. We know there are divisions in Muslim, but whatever name you give, there are going to be division. In the Hanafi Maslak, there were 4 students. In Shafi Maslak, there's Qadim and Jadid. In the Ahle Hadith, I went to Kashmir, there are many groups of Ahle Hadith. I went to Kerala, Mujahideen. KNM, Kerala Nazwatul Mujahideen. There people don't call themselves Ahle Hadith, Mujahideen. If you go to Saudi Arabia and say, I'm Ahle Hadith, what is this new Ahle Hadith? Very few people of the Saudis know who's an Ahle Hadith. For them, they know Salafi. But Salafi and Ahle Hadith belong to the same group, the names are different. In some country, Ansari. Fine. So, when he's saying call ourselves Salafi, that means the Ahle Hadith of India, they aren't Salafis. Fine. So here we realize that if you want to give a label, instead of Salafi, Muhammad is better. Instead of Muhammad is Muslim. Therefore, I say Atiullah Atiu. Therefore, I prefer calling myself Muslim. That's it. First a Muslim, last a Muslim. I'm not hurting any of my Muslim brothers, whether it's a Hanafi or a Shafi or a Hanbali or a Maliki or a Ahle Hadith or a Salafi. Believe me, I love all. I love all my Muslim brothers. I'm not here to hurt anyone's feeling. Therefore, I said, Tala vila kalmitin sawa im bainana bainakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. I'm coming to common terms. I respect Abu Hanifa, Imam Ahmad, Hanbal, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi. I respect the great scholars of this. I respect the Salafi Salihin. I follow them, Alhamdulillah. Therefore, first the Muslim, last the Muslim. Now, one of the second reasons for the disunity is which organization you belong to. Organization. I belong to Jamaat-e-Islami. I belong to Tabligh Jamaat. Ikhwani. So these organizations, what happens? If you follow Quran and Sunnah, but if you don't belong to my organization, I'm not with you. See, making organization is not wrong in Islam. Giving name to an organization, Jamaat-e-Islami, Jamiyat-e-Ahle-Hadith, no problem. Giving any name, Jamiyat-e-Ahle-Hadith, Jamaat-e-Islami, or center named after Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, any, no problem. But if that organization is following Quran and Sunnah, according to Salaf al-Salihin, it's the right organization, otherwise it is wrong. Give it any name. After Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him. After Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. After Ibn Taymiyyah, Allah be pleased with him. After Abu Hanifa, may Allah's mercy be on him. No problem. If that organization is following Quran and Sahih Hadith, as understood by the Salaf al-Salihin, it's the right organization. If it is not, reject the organization, whether its name is belonging to anyone, whether it's after Ibn Taymiyyah, or whether it is Salafi, whether Ahle Hadith, if it follow Quran and Sahih Hadith, according to the understanding of the Salaf-e-Salihin, it is the right organization. So forming organization is not wrong in Islam. Because like we are specialized in Dawah. Some people are specialized in Islah. Some people are specialized in science. No problem. But what happens if there are two organizations doing Dawah? Two organizations. Both are following Quran and Sunnah. But it does not belong to my organization, so I'm against him. I start giving fatwa. What fatwa? That person is a kafir. Takfir. Direct. Don't go to that organization. You know, people said, don't come to the peace exhibition. You know, Brother Zakir told me, people are telling, don't come to peace exhibition. Why? Because peace exhibition is not organized by me. If it was organized by me, then it is good. If it is organized by the Jamaat I belong to, it is a good exhibition. If it is not organized by my Jamaat, it's not a good organization. It's not a good exhibition. Why? We have to see Allah and His Rasul. If that organization, if that exhibition is following Quran and Sahih Hadith, according to the understanding of the Salaf-e-Salihin, it is the right organization. There's no problem. So making organization is no problem. As long as the organization is on the Quran and Sahih Hadith. So if you want to join any organization, verify for yourself whether that organization is the Quran and Sahih Hadith. If there's a difference in the Hadith and Quran understanding, as per the understanding of the Salaf-e-Salihin, the pious predecessors, the three generations, finished. Answer is easy. But people give fatwa. Takfir. We'll come to takfir later on. And according to the hadith of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 8, hadith number 637, the Prophet said, any Muslim who says kafir to another Muslim, it comes back to him. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 8, hadith number 6103, that any Muslim tells to another Muslim he's a kafir, he kills him. Now, based on this, the scholars, they said, great scholars, they said that you should not do takfir. Takfir means calling another Muslim, another believer a kafir. And there are various fatwas of these hadith that according to Hafiz ibn Hajar, he said that what the hadith of Sahih Bukhari says that if you call a Muslim a kafir, it comes back to you. That means the kufr comes back to you and you become a kafir. Sheikh Shaukhani, he said that do not call another believer a kafir until the proofs, the burhan, are as clear as the daytime of the sun. Unless it's clear to you that he's a pakka kafir. Proof. See, if you, it's not fard to call a kafir. It's not fard. Even if the Muslim may be a kafir, why are you giving a fatwa? Takfir. One calling another kafir outside the fold. So the various fatwas describing it is wrong. Now, as I mentioned, as far as calling the word Salafi, there are two groups of scholars. One group of scholars say it is fard. And I give you an example of Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani. I want to even let you know that Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, who I respect, he is the scholar of the present time, even he says calling Salafi is a fard. To a lesser extent, not very staunch, is Sheikh bin Baz. He says, fine, to identify yourself, no problem. But there are other group of scholars who say calling Salafi is wrong. Scholars who believe in Quran, Hadith, and Salafi Salihin. First, I will quote you the person who's respected the most amongst the Salafis of the present time, Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah. There's a book called The Call to Islam and the Caller, in which 40 hadiths are mentioned. The 40th hadith, the last hadith, is a hadith in which it is mentioned. It's hadith of Tirmidhi, hadith number 2600. There it is said that Allah's Messenger, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, said that I've been instructed with five things which I'm instructing to you. First is Jama'ah. First is Jama'ah. Jama'ah means following the three generations, the Salaf is following. Second is obeying. Third is hearing. Fourth is Hijrah. And fifth is Jihad in the way of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. First is Jama'ah, following Salaf al-Salih. Second is hearing. Third is obeying. Fourth is Hijrah. Fifth is Jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Five things. And anyone who goes away by a span's difference from the Jama'ah, he has thrown the yoke of Islam off his neck. And anyone who calls to anyone besides Allah, he is inviting you to the abode of hellfire. Hadith, classified as Sahih. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah says, after this hadith, in this book, that one of the Salaf, the pious predecessors, he said, that I don't know on which of the two things should I thank Allah more, for bringing me to Islam or for keeping me away from the innovators. One of the Salaf, he quotes, and he says, I don't know which of the two things should I thank Allah more, for bringing me Islam, for me becoming a Muslim, or for keeping me away from the innovators. You should call yourself only, even in the previous hadith of Tirmidhi, it ends by saying, if you call anything besides the way of the Allah, what Allah has called you, and he says, Muslim, Mu'min, and Abdullah. A Muslim, a believer, and the worship of Allah. If you call anything besides these three things to yourself, you're calling yourself to hellfire. Hadith. This Salaf, Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah quotes, that if you call anything, I don't know which thing should I thank more for Allah, for bringing me Islam or for keeping me away from the innovators. You cannot call anything besides what Allah has called you in the Quran. Muslim, Mu'min, and Abdullah. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah. So how can you quote saying Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah says you should call yourself Salafi? What Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah says, you have to follow the Salafi solo in whichever I say. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah never said call yourself Salafi. I'm quoting you another scholar, Shaykh Utaimi. Now see, all these scholars are stalwarts of the present time. All three expired now. Sheikh Nasir al-Albani, Sheikh bin Baz, Sheikh Utaimi. In the book of Until When Will We Differ, there's a book of Sheikh Utaimi. It's available there in the exhibition. Until When Will We Differ, on page number 36. An Indian asks Sheikh Utaimi a question. In my country, people call towards Ikhwani and Tablighi. Are they on truth or falsehood? Sheikh Utaimi gives the reply. If anyone calls himself as Ikhwani, calling towards Ikhwani, Tablighi or Salafi, he is on falsehood. The question of Salafi wasn't there. Sheikh Utaimi goes out of his way to say that anyone calls himself a Ikhwani, a Tablighi, or a Salafi, calling towards, it is on falsehood, not I. See, Dr. Zakir Naik is nothing in Islam. I am zero. Sheikh Utaimi, mashallah, has a caliber. So I am following the fatwa of Sheikh Utaimi. So any Salafi who points a finger at me will have to point the finger at Sheikh Utaimi. Now all these people on the website you go, they even say Sheikh Utaimi says call us a Salafi. What he says? Sheikh Utaimi says you should follow the Salafi Salih. But that even I say. So Sheikh Utaimi does not mind anyone following Salafi Salih. But if you call towards saying call yourself a Salafi, he says it is falsehood. Sheikh Utaimi. So Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani is on one extreme, fard. Sheikh Utaimi says it is wrong. But both agree. Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani also says that if you call yourself Salafi, thinking you're superior, then it is wrong. Sheikh Saleh Fawzan also says, if you say I'm a Salafi, I'm superior, then it is wrong. So even these first group of scholars who say calling Salafi is a fard, even they agree, if you call yourself Salafi and say that I'm superior, I will go to Jannah, others won't go, that is wrong. Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani, Sheikh bin Baz, Sheikh Utaimi, besides saying this, he says you should not call yourself a Salafi. I am not as staunch as Sheikh Utaimi. If you ask me, I said, preferably call yourself Muslim. If someone calls himself Salafi, in some cases can be Mubah. Fine, shortcut. I don't say it's haram. But I prefer safe, 100% safe Muslim. The scholars are differing, should call or not call. If someone is calling as a shortcut, instead of saying, I follow Quran, Hadith, and Salafi Salih, only till that extent, which is not the case. Most of the people, they say, Salafi, saved sect. Means all the others go to Jahannam. So this way it is wrong. For short reason, if you say, I say Mubah, not a Farad. I am more with the fatwa of Sheikh Saleh Munajjid. Sheikh Saleh Munajjid says, if you call for understanding that you do not belong to the innovators, there is no problem. But if someone calls saying, I'm a Salafi better, then it is wrong. And he quoted the hadith of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That at the time of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Madinah, there was a fight between the Ansar and the Muhajirs. So the Ansar said, oh Ansar, come to me. So all the Ansars piled behind Ansar. And the Muhajir said, oh Muhajir, come help me. The Prophet came to know, he said, what is this call of Jahiliya? See, if you analyze, calling Ansar is not bad, calling Muhajir is not bad. But here they were making groups. Ansar, come and help me. Muhajir, come and help me. The Prophet said it is the call of the Jahiliya. Though Ansar is a good name. Ansar means the helpers. Helper of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Muhajir means those who migrated in the way of Allah and His Rasul. It's a good name, but yet the Prophet said it is haram to identify yourself, I'm superior. So based on this, I don't say Salafi is haram. Don't get me wrong. But absolutely safe is Muslim. If you say Salafi and have a little bit of error and, you know, ego and all, problem may go to the, may be dangerous, which the Prophet prohibited. Therefore, safe is call innani min al-Muslimin, say that I'm a Muslim. Otherwise, I can say I'm a pakka Hanafi, pakka Shafi, pakka Hamli, pakka Malki, pakka Salfi, pakka Ilyas, no problem. But in label, call yourself a Muslim. I would like to end my talk by giving the opinions in the ending of these great scholars, which will open up your mind. According those people who say takfir, no takfir, kafir, kafir, Imam Shafi, may Allah's mercy be on him, he said that if calling the names, attributes of Allah, what Allah has given is that. Anything else is haram, is kufr. You can only call to names of Allah what he and his messenger have given, nothing else. Anything else is kufr. But if someone calls another name in ignorance, then he's not a kafir, Imam Shafi. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah, you know what he said? He said, if someone prostrates to a man and he thinks this is his deen, then he's not an unbeliever. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah. If someone does shudud to a man, Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah said, if someone does sajda to a man, to a human being, and thinks it is his deen, he is not an unbeliever until someone explains to him, and yet he's on it. Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah, what a great personality. Further, if you read Shaykh Shawqani, he said that if someone bows down to anyone besides Allah in ignorance, he's not an unbeliever. Muhammad Ibn Wahhab, may Allah's mercy be on him, he said that we do not call unbelievers to those people who bow on the idol of the grave of Abdul Qadir or on the idol of the grave of Ahmad Badawi or the likes of it. So how can we call unbeliever to those people who do not do shirk? We claim that we are knowledgeable, giving takfir, kafir, kafir, etc. I would like to end with the two hadiths of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in Sahih Muslim, volume number 3, hadith number 4565, that Arfaja, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that the Messenger of Allah said that there will be a time when evil things will happen in a community. And whenever a person disrupts the unity of the Muslim Ummah, strike him with the sword. And if he does not stop, kill him. A messenger said, anyone who tries to disrupt the unity of the Muslim Ummah, strike him with the sword. If he does not stop, kill him. Sahih Muslim, volume number 3, hadith number 4565. I would like to end my talk with the last hadith of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is from Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, hadith number 3606. I know the lecture is long. Last hadith. Here, Hudhaifa ibn Yaman, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that people like asking to the Prophet what things are good, but I, due to fear, like to ask the Prophet what is evil. And he asked the Prophet that we were in ignorance and evil, and Allah, through His guidance, He brought us to the good. Will there be any evil after this? The Prophet said, yes, there will be evil. Will there be any good after that evil? The Prophet said, yes, but with a little dakhan, with a little evil. So the Sahaba asked, what is that evil? The Prophet said, there will be some people who will call towards things which are not my prediction. The Sahaba asked, after that, will there be an evil? The Prophet said, yes. There will be people who will call you to the hellfire. So Hudhaifa, may Allah be pleased with him, he asked, what should we do? So the Prophet replied, hold fast to the group of Muslims and the chief. So the Sahaba asked, what if there is no group of Muslim and the chief? The reply of the Prophet is, if there are no group of Muslim or no chief, dissociate yourself from all the sects, even if you have to bite the root of the tree until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that state. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.